All right, hi. How's it going, everybody? DEI meeting, October 19th. Chaos. Good to have all of you here. I can share if you want to add. We need a prompt. We need somebody go get the prompt. You know, the.
The icebreaker prompt.
Yeah. We're missing that. All right. So while you're getting that, Elizabeth, I can share my screen too. All right. Pretty light group today. What do you, if you had one free, I do have one free hour each day. A free hour though. Let's see. Sleep. Yeah, that's a good one. That was, you wrote that really fast, by the way.
Yeah, I'm already there.
No thought goes into that one.
Yeah, just sleep.
I don't know what I do. Sleeping is good. Oh my gosh, I've been trying to finish a book for a long time.
Yeah, that's a good one. I would read.
Yeah.
I like to read.
It's kind of in the same world because you can do it while you're laying in bed and you might fall asleep while you're reading. So they're highly connected. Something also like dogs. Yeah, exactly. Walks are really good. I never want to do them, but then I do them and they're like, I'm like, why don't I do this all the time? You know?
It's pretty awesome.
It is. All right. Great. I hope everybody's doing okay these days. Ruth, Anita, you all doing okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. I actually traveled and I came to see Ruth.
Oh, great.
Yeah, so that's queen.
That's awesome. Where did you meet each other? In Nigeria or somewhere else?
Yeah, in Nigeria, Lagos. There's a conference here.
So. Oh, that's awesome. I've seen the conference just on like Twitter posts, but that's really awesome. Are you still there, Anita?
Yep.
All right.
I just got you today.
Oh, awesome. Awesome, awesome.
Just my sleeping room and I'm in your room so we don't echo.
That's fantastic. So Anita, Do you have any updates that you want to give us on the interview campaign that is, you know, that you're doing, or is that on hold while you travel?
No, I've actually been working on it throughout. So I've been able to send it out to a couple of persons and communities, and the feedback is not as positive as I expected, which I don't know how to react to that. We had 31 persons open the survey itself, but only 6 persons have completed it to the last page, and these persons are not opting to be interviewed one-on-one. I don't know if there's something we can do to remedy that, but I also got an opportunity from opensource.com to write an article about the survey to help spread more word, so I'm actually working on that right now.
That's great, actually. Okay, so would like more interview. Okay, that's awesome. Do you need a hand with the opensource.com article at all? Or are you good there, you think?
Yeah, I already drafted it out. So once I'm sure that it's perfect, I'll send it to the Slack for review.
Okay.
Before I forward it to opensource.com.
Okay.
And also, Force Them, I posted it in Force Them Discourse, and they said they want to get feedback from the survey by next year's Force Them. So I'm looking forward to that.
Okay, that's great. So based on this, do you have thoughts on how long you might want to keep it open?
I think I might extend the date.
Okay.
Yeah, because it looks like the turn up is not as fast as I thought. And I'll have to do a lot more marketing about it. So I'm reaching out to people that can help promote it.
Okay, I think that's okay in this case, because I don't think a lot of the questions in there are time sensitive questions. Yeah. You know, it's not like a survey associated with a conference or something where you kind of want to get the feedback, you know, within a week or something of the conference. So I think that's okay. As always, Anita, let us know how we can help as you need a hand.
All right.
Great. Ruth or Elizabeth, do you have questions or comments for Anita?
I think something that if we are like, if the like the people interviewing, like the people signing up to interview are going to be giving feedback on the chaos metrics, like regardless of if they have used it or not, right? It might be a reason why they might be opting out of the interview. Say for example, I have filled the form. Mm-hmm. I don't know about chaos. It's my first time hearing about chaos, and I would not want to interview to give feedback on chaos metrics. I don't know if that makes sense. So maybe the people not signing up might not be so much of a bad thing. It's probably because they do not have something to say, right? But I don't know if I'm getting this wrong about the why we are in, like the reason for the interview or.
No, you could be right. Yep.
Makes a lot of sense. And I actually indicated it there that if they're not familiar with the survey, then they should like glance through the metric. There's provision for that. But I think so many persons are not familiar with, because the response, you see a lot of persons say they've not heard of chaos before and they're just coming across this for the first time.
Okay. I'm wondering if, if maybe for the interviews, I agree with everything that's been said. Perhaps we could reach out directly for some of the interviews. Would that be bad, Anita? You know, like if they didn't take the survey, that's fine, but we still want to do a few interviews with people, because then we could be a little bit more specific. So for example, reaching out to, I'm thinking, say folks at Microsoft who are using the chaos, like we could identify organizations that we know are using the chaos metrics and possibly reach out directly to a few of those folks.
Okay, that can work.
Okay.
I think it's also good that folks are taking the interview that are not familiar with chaos and the metrics, because I think that that was kind of one of the central points, is that we get blinded by our own biases here. And like, you know, we know what we know and we see what we see, but we want to include other perspectives of folks that aren't as familiar with the metrics. We want to get their take on it. So it was partially to expand our own pool of perspectives that come into these metrics. So I think that's really good that people don't know about chaos. I just wonder if there's a way for us to maybe make it a little easier for them to read through the metrics. I don't know if like just giving them like a one page summary of all the DEI metrics and just say, here's kind of what we have put together so far. What do you think? And I mean, I'm assuming that, Anita, they will be pointed to like the metrics page. Is that right?
Yeah, I already did that. I created a notion page where I just curated all the DEI metrics for easy access.
Okay, perfect, perfect, perfect. Then never mind, I will shut up. But yeah, that's perfect. That's exactly what I was thinking about. Like that would be, So I mean, the only other thing I can think of is that, you know, we just reinforce that the whole, you know, that it's absolutely fine that they don't know about the metrics. And in fact, that's kind of the point. So, but I don't know. Yeah.
I think by the time we close the survey and we don't have enough persons to opt for the interview, we cannot reach out to the persons that are already using the chaos metrics in the communities that Matt has mentioned. So we can proceed with that.
That sounds great. So Anita, when you, if you feel like there's a time, these are just examples, if there are folks that you would like to reach out to, like just connect with me, Elizabeth, whomever, and we can help make some introductions if you don't know people at these organizations as well.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. One more thing, Anita. So there was a discussion about also promoting this at All Things Open.
Yeah.
And right now, Sophia Vargas from the Chaos Project and Google is going to be at All Things Open. And she said she's happy to talk about this, the work that you're doing there, I think kind of in an unconference or, you know, in informal way. So if maybe we could connect everybody to...
Yes. I think myself and Ruth contacted Sophia, but she said she might not be there in person that day because she'll be traveling in.
Okay.
Except she wants to talk about Asta, like Sunday is like the DEI day, mm-hmm. I think we have like, but Sophia said she'll be there on Sunday. So
it would work. So it will work. Okay.
It won't work because won't she'll work. Be there.
Okay, gotcha. So then maybe the other person, Ruth, who you know is Justin Flory. He's going to be there as well.
Okay.
And so maybe you could connect with Justin.
And I think Justin knows about this work already, right?
Yep, exactly. He probably has heard about it in the audit team. And he's also like just a really nice guy and probably willing to talk about the work that you're doing. So maybe reach out to Justin.
Yeah, I would.
Okay. Hi, Precious. Okay. Okay, great. All right. I'm just going to move on a little bit. So I just wanted to give you an update on project badging. A couple of you have been in these conversations already. I'm going to share a different screen here really fast. So I just wanted to kind of share some initial thoughts on where we're at with project badging. So the model that you're looking at here is trying to accommodate a whole variety of different needs and address a bunch of different constraints that we're pretty sure we have with respect to project badging. And the intention here is to try to build a system that does enable open source projects to be recognized for the work that they're doing at the project level, the DEI work that they're doing at the project level. And so I just wanted to walk through this really briefly. I'm glad this is being recorded so we can kind of, you know, if anybody watches this later, provide feedback as well. So, the way that the project, open source project badging would work is, I'm glad you like it, hopefully it makes good sense, is that for a bronze badge to be received, we will look for the presence of the DEI.md file that we've been talking about for quite some time now. And the DEIMD file would contain four metrics that we've also talked about for a while. It is things like newcomer experience and inclusive leadership. And so the test will be an automated test that will actually look for really just two things. One is the presence of the DEI.MD file in a repository. It's either present or it's not present. And then the second is the headers, so like kind of a representation in that file, a header for each one of the metrics with some real text behind those metrics. And the text for those metrics is meant to just kind of talk about how a particular project addresses a particular metric. And so we wouldn't actually look at the text that's written about how the community is addressing that metric. Really, all that we're doing is just ensuring that the text written is, is real text. It's not just some made up text. All right, and so based on the presence of the DEI.md file and the presence of these metrics in that file, we would award a bronze badge. And so that bronze badge would then trigger a process by which the badge would be awarded, similar to the event badging program. And then we'd also provide a report to that community, the community that submitted the request. And that report, at least in the first, would be something like an inclusivity report. And this would be an automated check on inclusivity within the project as done by Augur, Sean and the Augur team. And so the report is given to the community manager, again, that applied for the bronze badge. And that's the end of the bronze badge process. So they test for the presence of the file, the contents within the file. Upon having those passed, they get the badge and they get an inclusivity report. That's the end of it. If they would like to go on for a silver badge, we would still test for the presence of the DEI.md file along with all four of the metrics. Again, we would ensure that that is still there. But there would be one component added to the DEI.md file, and that component would be a narrative about how they addressed the inclusivity report that they received in the prior stage. And so we're just trying to ensure that the report that is private to the community is addressed in some form or fashion in the silver stage. Upon approving that, and again, we don't really look at the text, we just try to ensure that there's some good language behind how they address it, and this is all publicly available within their community, we would award a silver badge and we would generate a second report. And the second report could be perhaps an accessibility report. We're not quite sure what these reports would be yet. That report would be given to the community along with another run of the inclusivity report. And again, we would go to the gold stage. We would test for the DEI.md file, the presence of these metrics, and then how they have addressed the reports from the prior two stages, and so on and so forth into the platinum stage. So that's the current design. There are some nuances in this, but I just wanted to share this with anybody or with everybody here and see if there's any feedback or thoughts that you have on this approach. Or Elizabeth and Ruth, I know you've seen this before, things that you've thought about, you know, over the course of the last couple of days. Good. Silence. I have no idea what you're talking about. Silence. It all looks good.
Yeah, it all looks good to me. I have seen it before.
I know.
Like something I'm still thinking about it, but defining the reports, what entails, like, for example, we have the bronze report, right? That talks about, like, gives detail about inclusivity. And then you said like the silver badge, accessibility. So I think defining are they going to be from our metrics or like different components of the DEI metrics? I think that would be like those focus areas that we have. I know we do. I think I see Precious's message on the chat. So those focus areas that we have about project and community, I think the other one, but then they are already in the DEI.md file. So I don't know if it would kind of, the report is going to be human given, right? It's going to be something human given. So
yeah, so the report will be like, let's say you were a community manager for a particular project and you submitted the request for a bronze badge. You would get the report privately, Ruth, as the center. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
So we wouldn't post those publicly.
Yeah, but okay, I think then we are thinking about the different kinds of reports that we'd have across these different badge levels.
Correct. And this is, we're not sure what those reports would be. Right now, I'm just calling them like silver report, you know, gold report. We'd have to figure that out. And I think part of that, Ruth, is the conversations that Sean wants to have. And this is where member Elizabeth can help out with folks, communities at GitHub, that we might be able to think through what those reports could be based on what people would really like to see from a reporting perspective.
I also just want to mention, if there are concerns about the automation of this and like people cheating on their DEI.MD file, that is a possibility that someone would do that. I think, I forget who said this yesterday, but if you're cheating on your DEI file, then then you need to look at your community. Like, that's a huge red flag. And I think we will leave it to the overall open source community to like report back, like, hey, this person is not, you know, being genuine in their DEI.MD file. But again, it's all public. And so if you're going to do that, then you're going to not look very great to your community. So just wanted to say that there is kind of like a self-policing component of this.
I'm starting to believe that just having the DEI.MD file public, you know what I mean? It's available on the repositories, and it might even be something that communities link to on their web page. Like, that's actually a peer review in itself. And so, you know, how, remember, we wanted peer review early, but at this point, we're basically just saying, listen, if you're going to go through these stages, to your point, and lie about things, like, your community should be peer reviewing you. You know, so like if you're saying we provide financial support for travel, and they're like, where show me the link where you're doing this. And so hopefully the community can provide some peer review as well, because we just don't have the capacity to do that type of peer review.
Yeah, so I think our hope is that anyone who is trying to game the system or skirt past the actual requirements, they're gonna get called out by their community. They're not gonna call like CHAOSS out or like somebody else out for giving this badge. Like, that's the hope, I think, is to let them police themselves and
yes. And
place the attention where it belongs, not on us.
Don't blame us. And I'm gonna find the current DEI.MD file. I can never seem to find it. I need to make it more findable for me.
I think there's a version in that all-in issue.
Okay.
You have access.
Yeah. I think Precious has a question about, are these listed out for these organizations? To know, yeah, we do have.
Yeah, they'll get a template of which to work from. So, yeah.
Is there one in here?
Or maybe you just talked about it in that issue. I don't know.
Maybe.
I know it's
somewhere. Yeah. Let me try to find it, because I think it's an important, it is an important document. I found it. Give me a second here. All right, I put it in the minutes, and then I'll put it in the chat here. That's the DEI.MD file. And so, share my screen again. So this is the DEI.MD file. It's really just this top part up here. And so we would have newcomer experience, project burnout, and so on and so forth. And then really all that DEI.MD file bot is looking for is the presence of this document in its entirety, and then the presence of this header, and so on and so forth. And so, and just ensuring that there's actually some text written there. And so there's been some really great like kind of statements as to like here, as to what this DEI-MD file provides and what it doesn't provide. I think this is a really important disclaimer for us. We're just kind of setting the scope as to what we are claiming to do with this. And then how, and this is, I'm not sure if the code of conduct team is the right team. It probably is, to be honest with you. But to your point, Elizabeth, like if you're like, that is not true, you know, this doesn't represent us, that you do have just encouragement to reach out and kind of challenge, but it's the challenge or to question the statement, that questioning goes within the community itself, not to us. So does this help? I don't know if Precious, was that you who had asked about this document, like what the metrics are that are in it? I think that was answered as well, but here's the whole document in full.
I really like how this has evolved. I think it sounds really, really good. I really like this doc.
Yeah, I completely agree. I love the doc. And at this point, you know, I think we're close. We can just start kind of filling out like what examples could be in here. We might want to provide that. Just have a little bit of work to do here. But I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, I think I gave one thought to rank this, like puts inclusive leadership, because I think project burnout is not like it's not so common, but I think inclusive leadership and recognizing contributors could rank up.
Mm-hmm. So then I'm gonna show
something I thought about too, like I don't know where to put this, but how communities educate their contributors about DEI issues. Like, for example, I'll give an example. You know, there are different other communities or different other types of contributors that might not understand DEI issues, like, you know, using inclusive language. Maybe we might want to think about how communities do educate their members about DEI issues, things like this. So you know when to use inclusive language. I think that's something we might want to think about in the future too. I don't know where that fits in, but.
I think that fits into the code of conduct. Because a lot of them, you see something about inclusive language in code of conduct.
So it may fit as well, Elizabeth, because I know that you're the person up here. So there's a portal, from what I understand, that would be created kind of as part of the all-in project. And correct me if I'm wrong, Elizabeth, but like it would provide resources, what you're talking about a bit, Ruth. I like the extension of how as a community manager, you can educate your community as well. I think that's a really nice extension that I hadn't really thought about. Everything else has been like, here's what you can do. But it hasn't always been about here's how you can educate other people on what to do. And you know, educating the educators is a really good thing. And then, you know, like the idea up here as well is, let's say that there are 100 projects they go through the bronze badge stage and they receive the inclusivity report, whatever it might be, that we could provide, all in would provide training sessions saying, like, hey, you're a community and you received the inclusivity report. Join us on Friday at 10 o'clock to learn how to think about that report and how to integrate that report into better centering DEI within your community. So it wouldn't be a one-on-one training type of thing or a one-on-one session, but we could invite anybody who has received that inclusivity report. And likewise, we could run another session for an accessibility report and so on and so forth. So the idea is we also, oh, and then in this portal as well, there would be potential like mentorship possibilities. What did you call it, Elizabeth? It's not like where you as a, you're like, I really need help thinking about my inclusivity report. And another community could say, oh, we already did this. We're happy to help you think about ways to include that. Well, I forget what you called that.
Mentor. Yeah, I think we're like matchmaking or something. Matchmaking. I don't really like that. Like that okay. Doesn't, but yes, that whole idea.
So we would provide resources. We could provide sessions, education sessions. Maybe education sessions is better here. And outreach, just ways to support and address the reports. So it's a whole learning component throughout all of this. It's not just us checking for the presence and giving them reports, and then checking for the presence and then giving them reports, checking, you know, like it's more than that. This is kind of a functional part down here, and this is the educational part up here on the top. So do you think that helps? Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to add, when you think of like project maintainers, like they're not necessarily equipped with the skills or the tools to know how to do all this stuff. Like they just, most of them just started with code, you know, and like that's, they just wanted to share their code with the world. And now they are kind of also responsible for creating this community of awesomeness. And so I think that education piece is a huge part of it, to Matt's point. And the fact that what I think the goal of this whole thing is to have projects progress levels, not judge them or, you know, give them like a label, but to help them progress. And that will be the way we, the success metric, if you will, or like how we know it's working, is if projects are moving up the ladder and they are improving and their reports show that, and they can show their community that as well, because that's it, really the end result of this whole thing, the end goal.
And then one last part that I'll just add onto this, you can see that there's a lot of maybe education resources that are required or technical pieces that are required. So for example, if you have an inclusivity report, perhaps somebody has a publicly available tool that can be run against your repository to not only identify areas, challenges around inclusivities, but ways to improve it. Or if there's a piece of software out there that can not only identify concerns around accessibility, but also suggest ways to improve accessibility. If there are tools or educational resources that we're not sure exist in the world, but people are working on them and can kind of help such a process along, the intention is to have a financial support program or a grants program to support projects that can also plug into this model to really kind of help expand or make it better for everybody. So it's not just CHAOSS and All In that have the answers here. It's a community of people that have the answers and to provide support in that regard as well. So that's kind of an underlying component on this as well. Elizabeth, I don't know if you wanted to add anything to that.
I do, actually.
Great.
So yeah, if you do know, if people on this call or anybody watching this video, if you do know of open source projects that are working in the DEI space, if you can do me a favor and let me know who those are, that would be awesome. And also, I am starting to collect those resources, educational resources for maintainers. So if anybody has like talks they've seen or articles they've read, blog posts or written talks they've given, and they want to include those in this resources list, that'd be great if you could just let me know, and we'll sort it all out and figure out how to get that added. So oh great, thank you so much, Precious, that's awesome. Num focus, I will check that out for sure. Thank you.
Cool, right on. And if anybody on this call has a particular interest to get involved as well, it's open. This is, you know, going to be developed in the open and talked about in the open. So this is not a closed project. That's the intention. The more people, the better. All right, Precious, you're now officially included. Awesome. All right, let me go back. All right, so that's that. There was an event badging update. Elizabeth, I'm guessing that's from you. Do you want to give an update on that, or?
I can.
In there too.
Or Ruth, you put it in there.
Yeah, go ahead, Ruth. Yeah, I can't.
We've had like a lot of events, which is really interesting. I did watch the repository, so my email has been so full, which is exciting. And we have Elizabeth has the, I think on the 26th, a call to like onboard some cool people to become badgers. So yesterday, I think it was on the community call, I think Elizabeth mentioned something about, you know, the Linux Foundation meeting all the checks. So I just had like a quick talk about revising what we have on the list, like on the checklist. And not just revising it because we want to revise it and not allow the Linux Foundation mark all the checks. But I think as we attend events, we should just have it in mind to ask or to maybe reach out to event organizers about things that they see that could be improved on DEI, like as regards to events or even with attendees, right? So maybe in the next couple of conferences that anyone from the DI working group is attending, or we could start thinking about these potential things and see things that we might be missing out that people, you know, look forward to seeing at events that help DI. So I think that's just what I want to say. So we can, it would inform us revising these metrics again, like the checklist, and seeing things that we might be missing out on, because I see a lot of times that we get to the applicants that have applied in the past, they have improved based on what we have. They have improved. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I'm breaking up, right? Anita just told me I'm breaking up. And then my screen's frozen.
We can still hear you.
I hear you just fine.
Okay, so like it will just help inform the metrics that we are creating. Like if we get feedback from attendees, things that even when we are saying these conferences, like all those things that we see that, you know, help DEI stuff. So yeah, that's one thing I wanted us to think about for events badging.
Ruth, to that point, I know we have gotten feedback in the past that, and it's a huge gap as we're missing, is we don't ask anything about event accessibility. So that has been on my list to add for months. I think it's tricky to add anything right now just because it's in such a flux, and it's been in flux for a little while. And I think that's what's holding us up. But, you know, the badging application to the website, like there's like this, you know, how everything's switching over. So I 100% agree. And I think that that's an excellent point. And I would love to see accessibility. So I'm thinking, like in my head, I was thinking like, I don't know, 2023 early, as soon as like the badging website is done and that whole process is down and the flow works, then maybe we can add more things in. I think accessibility is a big, huge piece that's we're not asking anything about. And to that, to the second thing on that is, I have gotten feedback from event organizers, specifically the folks at FOSS Backstage. I talked with them for a while about our metrics, and they have a real interest in connecting with other event organizers. So that is something else that I would like to put on the kind of the roadmap, if we have one, for 2023, is like building that community a little bit better and connecting these folks together and including people besides just LF folks in this process. So I would love to put that somewhere on the to-do list. Maybe I'll open an issue or something to talk about that, because I know they are very interested in connecting and seeing how they can do better on their side. So thank you, Ruth. Yeah, totally.
We've talked about the kind of expanding beyond the LF for a while now. And I think part of like kind of like part of it has been just having enough people who can do reviews. Like, we've always been a little hesitant to really be aggressive in reaching out, but gosh, if there are 10 people that are going through the review process, I mean, now might be a good time to kind of onboard the 10 additional people and also connect. Is it like it's other event organizers that FOSS Backstage is connected with?
Yeah. They have their own, they're developers, but they also have their own like open source event company that they run conferences on. And FOSS Backstage is one that they've gone through a couple of times. They've put it through. And so I spoke with them on the phone. They reached out to me and were like, hey, can we talk about these metrics and how we can be better and what we can do? And so, yeah, right. I have been in contact with them quite a bit. And so I really want to connect them with the LF, because I'm like, LF, they know, like they got it down, like they're doing a really good job. And so yeah, just building that community out. And to Matt's point earlier about the new class of onboarding badgers. Yeah, so we have 10 people signed up for that orientation right now. And just for a bit of context, we have 12 people that are listed right now as reviewers. We have 7 that are occasional reviewers. So this will essentially double our team almost. And so I'm super excited. So thank you, Ruth, for pushing this wherever you go. I'm in love with it. Like, thank you so much. It's so helpful. And because the current team now, I mean, September, and I think it's either March or May, I can't remember, but we'll have another huge flood as the spring conferences, you know, they get all their schedules set. So September, October, and like April, May, those are our two big things. So hopefully we'll have this team onboarded and great, ready to go for the spring. So that's the goal.
Yeah, I think I'll look out for the issue. So, you know, when you have the issue open, then we can get to start working on it and thinking about it. So yeah, I think we should get that issue opened. And maybe Matt wants to do it, because Matt will do it in like 5 seconds.
Yeah, he's like on it. I think there is a couple of issues open in the badging repo from feedback from prior applicants and prior reviewers. So yeah, maybe we could just use those. They're old issues. I kept them open because it's like I don't want them to get lost. So maybe we can just kind of pop them up to the top.
Or something. I went through during this talk, I was kind of perusing the DEI issues as well, the work group issues, because a few of them, like events, there were a few suggestions like from 2020 and 2021. To be honest, it feels like we've addressed a lot of them, but it's probably still worth being a little bit more deliberate in looking at them. Okay, everybody, we're at the end of time. You're all amazing. We're done.
All right, we
didn't even assign a lead next week. We kind of just do this one by committee sometimes.
Yeah,
it's and fine. So I'm okay with that. So till next time, till next week, thank you everybody. It's great to see all of you. Take care.
Have a good day, guys. Bye.